Come on in, come on in. When you jump on in, let me know how you're doing this morning. Let me know how are you this morning. Come on in the room as I invite. And when you jump on, let me know how your morning is going. All right, let's get roll call this morning. Miss Franklin, thank you for chiming on. Miss Humphrey, thank you so much for chiming on. Miss Hutchinson, thank you so much for chiming on. Rachel, thank you so much for chiming on. I pray that everybody is having a blessed and wonderful morning this morning. I pray that the favor of God finds you well this morning. I pray that you know that this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I pray that you will let your light shine today, that men may see something in you that'll bring God glory. What's going on, Kawana? Thank you so much for chiming on. It is Wednesday, hump day. Again, thank y'all so much for your support. Don't want to take that for granted, because you don't have to be on this morning. You don't have to listen to anything that we have to say during the week, but you choose to. And so we appreciate that. I appreciate you for being on this morning. We are in Job chapter 34. Job chapter 34. And if you didn't get a chance to check out our dear brother Aaron on Monday, he was in Job chapter 31. And our dear sister Angela was in Job chapter 32 and Job chapter 33 on Tuesday. So if you didn't get a chance to hear them, I would encourage you to go back in him too and check them out. They have done a wonderful job this week. I think we have all done a good job allowing the Holy Spirit to allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to us through the book of Job, right? And so if you've been walking with us through the book of Job, I pray that you are being encouraged. I will be in Job chapter 34 on today. I'm going to be talking about justice. Job wanted it, and his friends wanted him to have it. I'm going to be talking about justice. Job wanted it, and his friends wanted him to have it. It is beginning, to me anyway, it is beginning to kind of get redundant, right? We see this dialogue and conversation that Job every day, every week is having with his friends about his situation. And basically, Job is trying to declare that he has experienced injustice. There's nothing that he can recall. There's nothing. Hey, Vermin, thank you for chiming on. There's nothing that he has done, or there's nothing that he has done, is doing to put him in the situation that he's in, right? And he's asking God for answers, or he's looking to God for answers, or he's looking to God to be delivered, or he's looking to God for justice. And I think in one of his conversations that he has with God, as his friends are listening, and Job is having a conversation with God, and he's having a conversation with his friends. So, hey, Angela, thank you so much for chiming on. And so I think Job goes on to say, if I could speak to God on my behalf, if I could represent myself in the courtroom, basically, and speak on my behalf, you know, hey, Chelsea, thank you so much for chiming on this morning. And as I know some of you are on your way to work, some of you may be driving. I pray that the traveling grace of God will be with you as you drive to work this morning, or as you're preparing to go, you're getting ready to go. So I'm going to dropping off the kids, wherever this video finds you. Again, I pray that God's favor, his grace, his protection will be with you. And so Job is saying that, I wish I could defend myself, because I'm looking to be justified. I'm looking for justice in my situation because I don't understand it, right? And as Job is looking for justice, his friends are telling him that you are getting justice for your works. So his friends are saying, Job, while you're asking for justice, we're telling you that you're getting justice, because God wouldn't allow these things to happen if you hadn't done something to deserve it, right? And so Job is looking for justice, and his friends are saying, you already have justice. Hey, First Lady Haynes, thank you so much for chiming on. And so I thought it was interesting that this is what I saw in this chapter dealing with justice. And we will see the word justice quite a few times. I thought it was interesting that this is what I saw in this chapter about justice, after hearing or knowing what the culture of what we have been dealing with these past week or so. Hey, Ms. Green, thank you for chiming on. I hope I'm saying his name right. Bacham, Case, Amber, Case and Trial, and not just that case and trial, but if we didn't, as people living in America or people living in our communities, if we didn't deem to desire justice, right? There would be no reason to look to the judicial system for help or for justice. What do you mean? So if somebody was to, God forbid, but if somebody was to do something wrong to a family member of yours or mine, the first thing that we want to do is run to the courts for justice. If you're being mistreated on your job, or you're being treated unjustly on your job, the first thing you want to do is look in the bylaws and look in your standard operating procedures to see and show, hey, that this is not right. Right? If what's going on, Brent? Thank you for chiming on, bro. If you go to work, right, like you told your employer that you was going to work, then there is an expectation that after you have given them so many hours that they're going to pay you for that. And if they fail to do that, then in your eyesight, that is unjust. And so you want your paycheck because you got bills, right? Charter or DirecTV or TXU or whatever electric company don't want to hear my job is treating me unjust because they hadn't paid me that. They hadn't paid me yet. No, they want their money because this is the agreement that you guys made. And so everybody wants justice. Everybody wants to be treated fairly. Everybody wants equality, right? And we should, right? And Job wants the same thing, right? Job is crying out for the same treatment, right? And that is what we're going to see. And so without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into it. For those that are chiming on, I am in Job chapter 34. And this is Elihu, one of Job's friends, talking once again, right? So 1-4 says, listen to me, you wise men. Pay attention, you who have knowledge. Job says, the ear tests the words it hears, just as the mouth desires food. So let us discern for ourselves what is right. Let us learn together what is good. So Elihu is now all of Job's friends are older than he is, right? Elihu deems to be the smart one. I think I said this last time when I talked about him. Out of his friends, or the intelligent one. And so Elihu says, listen to what Job says. And not only listen to what Job says, but let's discern. Hey, Latina, thank you for chiming on. Let's discern the information that is given to us on today, right? So listen and discern. Now, before I go any further, I want to acknowledge that the very thing that Job's friends are declaring are not wrong. Like some of the things that they are saying are on point, are right, but they're just not the knowledge is not wrong, but their wisdom is. And sometimes we can have knowledge but no wisdom, and wisdom teaches us how to discern the knowledge that we have and use it for every situation. So although they're not wrong, they're just not right in this situation. And so most of the time, Job friends are saying, God is going to do this to the wicked. God is going to do that to the wicked. The wicked will not get away. The wicked will get punished. And they are true based on their knowledge. But in this situation, trying to analyze Job's what Job is going through, they're not using wisdom, and they're wrong. And so Elihu says that first we got to listen, and first we got to discern. And I want us to know that in order to bring justice to a situation, we have to listen. Hey, Tasha, thank you for chiming on. We have to listen to all the facts. And not only listen to all the facts, but we have to give an ear to all of the truth. Hey, April, thank you for chiming on. And not only do we have to listen to everything that's being brought to the table, but we have to have a discerning ear to hear what is being brought to the table, right? So you need these two key ingredients in order to analyze or bring justice to a situation. Elihu says, listen and discern. Listen and discern. Listening and discerning is vital to coming up with a conclusion on any matter, right? I didn't watch this case, right? That was on TV, and a lot of times it was streaming from social media, and a lot of times I don't like to watch when I've already made a judgment in my mind that it wasn't going to end well, because it kind of messes up, you know, my mood. And I didn't want anything to mess up my day. I didn't want anything, you know, so I didn't watch it. And because I didn't watch it, there was some key information or truths or facts to the story that I didn't know. And I began to judge everything based on how I felt and what I thought without gathering all the information. And it is impossible to bring justice or demand justice to a situation when you don't have all of the information, or when you haven't heard all of the information, right? And so again, we need to listen, and we need to have discernment. Verses 7 and 9. And I just want to point out in this text, or in this chapter, I want to point out Elihu's wisdom on bringing justice to a situation. That's all I want to do today, right? And so verses 7 through 9, it says, tell me, has there ever been a man like Job, with his thirst for, with his conversation and how we talk? He chooses evil people as companions. He speaks his time. He spends his time with the wicked men. With wicked men, he has even said, "Why waste time trying to please God?" Let me read that again. Elihu says, tell me, has there ever been a Job, have there ever been a man like Job? He talk a lot. He chooses evil people as his companions, and he spent time with wicked men. He has even said, why waste time trying to please God? And so this is why it's so important to have discernment. Hey, Twyla, thank you so much for chiming on. This is why it's so important to have discernment when it comes to judging the truth or bringing justice to a situation. When a lie is mixed with truth, it can cause you to see or believe what is not relevant. When a lie is mixed with truth, it can cause you to see and believe what is not even relevant. Discernment shows us how to navigate through false truth. And so Elihu first says, Job chooses evil people to be his companion. We've never seen that since we've been reading the book of Job. Not only have we never seen that since we've been reading the book of Job, I think not last week, but the week before, Job begins to define his character prior to going through this situation. And when he defines his character prior to going through his situation, he lets us know that men respected him. And he sat amongst the elders, right? Old men was itching to hear the wisdom and the knowledge that came out of Job's mouth. So we never see, hey, Miss Constance, thank you so much for chiming on. And for those that are chiming on, I'm in Job chapter 34. We never seen Job have wicked men to be his companion. Then Elihu says that evil men be his companion. Then Elihu says that he spends time with wicked men. Like, we've never seen, the only men thus far that we've seen Job spend time with is his friends. So Elihu, are you talking about yourself? Are you talking about, or are you lying? Right? But this is the truth that Elihu says. The last sentence to this verse, he says, he even said, why waste time trying to please God? Now, hey, Jill, thank you for chiming on. Now, we did hear Job say that. You know, in the beginning, I think in verse 3 or 4, I mean, in chapters 3 and 4, when Job first began to go through what he was going through, he didn't understand why. He was like, well, what's the purpose of being a righteous man when I have to endure and go through the same thing that wicked men has to go through? So what's the purpose of submitting myself to you? What's the, if I got, and I thought like that before, right? Okay, God, what's the purpose of trying to live right when everything is always going wrong? Like, what's the purpose of trying to be committed to a God that I've never seen before when wicked men are not being committed and they're just doing whatever they want to do and it seems like they have everything that I want? So what's the purpose? Right? And so Job did say that. But the other thing that Elihu said did not happen. And so we have to realize that the devil is so crafty in twisting the truth. That's why it's important as mature believers that we submit to the wisdom of God and the following of the Holy Spirit. That's one of the reasons why when Christ Jesus left, he gave us the Holy Spirit, because it is the Holy Spirit that will lead and guide us into all truth. That's his responsibility if we're willing to listen and follow, right? And so let's take it back to the garden. Remember Eve, right? The devil was able to convince Eve that eating the fruit on the tree will open up her eyes and she will become more like God. And so the devil said, what did God say about this particular tree? Eve said, God told us not to eat of it. And the enemy said, the reason why God told you not to eat of it, he did tell you not to eat of it, but the reason why God told you not to eat of it is because that he knows that the day you eat of it, you're going to become just like him. Right? Being able to discern truth. And so the enemy tricked Eve by using what God said and adding falsehood to truth. And Eve was like, you know what? You sure right. This apple or whatever the fruit was, this tree, Bible says that as she began to look at the tree, the Bible says that her desire or her eyes begin to be open. And that's why it has to be, that's why we have to be so careful when bringing justice to a situation or hearing the information of a thing, that we focus on the truth of it and not all these other false things that has nothing to do with it. In the trial, I don't know if you remember, but they was trying to talk about the character of, and I hope I'm saying his name right, Botham, right? Talking about, you know, he smoked weed and all this other stuff, which has nothing, him smoking weed had nothing to do with what happened. Him smoking weed had nothing to do with the lady walking into the wrong house and him sitting in his own house and being killed. Right? Had nothing to do with it. But the defense will love for you to focus on that so you can come up with a falsehood of information to veer your decision another way. Right? So Elihu saying that the God that we serve, right, he is a just God. And that's why we have to have discernment to hear the information. And that's why it's important to follow truth. Jesus said, you should know the truth and the truth will set you free, or the truth will bring you justice, right? So we need to know, or we need to follow the truth, not the false truth or the false allegation or the craftiness of men to slide in things that are irrelevant to bring justice to a situation, right? John 8:32, I've already said that. And Jesus said, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Verses 10 and 12. Elihu says, listen to me, you who have understanding. Everyone knows that God doesn't sin. The Almighty can do no wrong. He repays people according to their deeds, works. He treats people as they deserve. Verse 12. Truly God will not do wrong. The Almighty will not twist justice. Elihu says the Almighty will not twist justice. So right now, Elihu is giving us a description of the judge. And he's saying that the judge is understanding. The judge does not sin. The judge can do no wrong. The judge doesn't repay people. The judge will repay people according to their deeds. Based on what you did, that's what the judge is going to give you. And the judge will not twist his justice. And I think that's important, because the judge has to be just. And we know that we serve a just judge. And so if God is a representation, or if Christ Jesus was a representation of who we should be like in the earth, then in our judgment, we have to be just, right? Or in our decision making, or in our bringing justice to a situation, we can't be twisted. We can't be influenced to twist the justice of a situation, right? Psalm 7 and 11 says, God is honest. God is an honest judge. He is angry with the wicked every day. Psalm 7 and 11. I'll say it again. Psalm 7 and 11 said that God is an honest judge. He is angry with the wicked every day. But I know what you're saying. But God, you told me to love my enemies. And God did tell us to love our enemies. But loving your enemies is not loving your enemies is not apart from bringing justice to their wicked deeds. Like, you can't separate love from discipline. You can't separate love from the consequences of a person's actions. That's part of love. So I can love my enemy. And then one of the things we have to understand is that God's anger is not like our anger. God has a righteous anger, right? Sometimes our anger is not righteous because we want to get back at people. We want to repay people for something that they did with us. Like, our anger is not like God's anger. God has a righteous anger, right? But we can't separate. Scripture says that God chastised those that he loved. So a lot of times we want to focus on the love of God, but we want to do away with the chastisement of God or the justice of God. No, I can't separate God's chastisement from his love. Like you can't, just like you can't separate forgiveness from justice. They come hand in hand. Love and discipline come hand in hand. If you ever, and I know parents may not be doing this now, but I know when we was growing up, like when our parents whooped us, they whooped us talking to us. Like, I'm doing this because I love you. Bah! Bah! I'm doing this because I care for you. Bah! Bah! You know, they hitting you with that whip or that tree branch or that belt. They bring in correction. They're bringing discipline. They're bringing justice because of your actions. Elihu says that he repays people according to their deeds. He treats people as they deserve. That is a just God. That is a loving God. But in the midst of his love, there's still correction. There's still discipline. And there's still justice. Right? Verse 17, and I'm almost finished. I hope y'all understand where I'm going with this and what I'm trying to say when it's pertaining to Job looking for justice and Job's friends telling him, bro, you done already got justice. What you're going through is just, right? Verse 17. Could God govern if he hated justice? Could God govern? Elihu asked a question. Could God govern if he hated? Could God be appointed over all these things if he wasn't just? No. And sometimes the position that we take as men, whether it be the position on the job, whether it be a title on the job, whether it be your title in a household, your title, when you get married, you become a husband or you become a wife, right? That title comes with certain responsibilities that you have to govern things over. And in being a governor or govern things that God has given you, hey, Mama Woods, we still praying for you and your family, right? I don't want you to think that we have forgotten as y'all continue to walk through this moment of grief. Just want you to know we're lifting you up. Just wanted to say that, felt the need to say that. As you get a title or whatever, that title or that position comes with certain responsibilities, right? And one of those responsibilities is you have to be just. It demands your position demands, especially when you are. When you are governed over other people, like, there has to be justice. And I'll say this right quick. If y'all are coming, one of the reasons why I'm not responding to the comments, if y'all are coming, I don't see them, right? So I just didn't want you to think I'm ignoring you. I just don't see the comments. If you go to, I want to say it's in Ephesians. I'm not, I want to, well, anyway, I think I want to say Ephesians 8 or 9, something like that. Well, Paul is talking about, The role of a family, like he, or the role of a person's life. He begins to talk about the husband and wife, like husband, love your wife like Christ loved the church. Then he tells the wife to respect her husband. And then he tell both of them, y'all need to submit one to another. Then he tells the children, he said, look, children, obey your parents in the Lord. You know, for this, right? Then he tells the fathers not to provoke your children to wrath, right? Then he tells he tells the employee, look, you need to work as you working unto the Lord. Then he tells the employer, you need to treat your workers like God has treated you, right? And then after he said all that, then he said, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. So Paul is giving us what it looks like, what the responsibility is to be head or to be governed over something. You have to do things the right way. And when you don't do things the right way, there are consequences for not doing things the right way. So everything that God created, right, was good and governed by law. Everything that God created was good. On the fifth day, he created this, it was good. On the sixth day, he created this, it was good. But everything he was created was governed by law. There was a law set in place from the beginning. And it had to be governed by the law that God set in the earth. And when the law was broken, forgiveness and justice follow. What you mean when you say that? Okay, I'm going to say it again. Everything that God created was governed by his law in the beginning of creation, in Genesis. And when the law was broken, there was forgiveness, but justice followed. So you can't get rid of it. You can't separate forgiveness and justice. You can't separate love and consequences. They both come hand in hand. When Adam and Eve sinned, the first thing that Adam and Eve noticed is they was naked. Right? What's going on, Robert? The first thing that Adam and Eve noticed is they was naked. As soon as God, his voice walked through the garden, he said, Adam, where are you? He said, God, I hid myself because I was naked. God said, how did you know that you was naked? Oh, I know how you sinned. And because you sinned, and now that you notice you naked, I'm going to show you grace and mercy and forgiveness by killing an animal and covering you up. But just because I cover you up, don't think that you're going to get away with your deeds. Ellie, you said that the just judge repays people according to their deeds. And so Adam and Eve, I'm going to cover your sins up. I'm going to forgive you for what you've done. But my forgiveness does not come without consequences. Adam, you're going to have to work from the sweat of your brow. Eve, your childbirth is going to be hard now. And your affections are going to be to your husband. The serpent, you're going to crawl on your belly from now on. Right? So I'm letting you know that I love you by covering you. But at the same time, there has to be justice, or there has to be consequences for your deeds. Like, there have been so many times that I have done something in my relationship with Christ, in my mature level. And I would like to think that I am mature in my relationship with God. I would like to think that anyway. But there have been so many times that I messed up. Like, there have been so many times that I did things wrong. Right. And I cried out to God. God, please forgive me. God, I apologize and I'm sorry. And because of the fellowship, because of the relationship that I have with the Creator, I'm promised. Forgiveness is in my inheritance. But it does not, just because forgiveness is in my inheritance, it does not separate me from the consequences that God will give me because of my disobedience. And no matter how hard I cried, no matter how hard I prayed, no matter how hard I fasted, no matter how hard I said I'm sorry, no matter how hard I said, God, please take it away. Or please don't let me go through this. There were some things that I had to go through because that was the law. That was the order of what God had put in place. Right? We're just talking about justice. Job is looking for it. Job's friends telling Job that that's what you got. So that's all we're talking about this morning. And I'm almost finished. Verses 21 and 24. And it says, for God watches how people live. Elihu. Elihu says, for God watches how people live. He sees everything they do. No darkness is thick enough to hide the wicked from his eyes. We don't set the time when we will come before God in judgment. I'm going to read that again. We don't set the time when we will come before God in judgment. Verse 24. He brings the mighty to ruin without asking anyone, and he sets up others in their place. And sometimes this is hard to swallow. And I tell you what. God sees all and will bring judgment in his timing. And sometimes this is a hard pill to swallow when you're fighting and standing for what it is, for what should be right. Like, when you're fighting and standing and looking for justice and you don't see justice in a situation, sometimes it's a hard pill to swallow to say, God, I know that at the end, although man didn't get it right, God, I know that you're going to deal with it. Sometimes that's a hard pill to swallow because you're standing for what's right. When you have been treated wrong on your job and there's no resolution to what you know is being unjust, you know, sometimes it's hard to, you want to see justice right then and right there. You want to see justice take place because it's right. It's only right. But sometimes we don't always see it. And we have to trust and depend on God that at the end of the day, although man needs to be held accountable for the laws that he has put in place in the earth, God, because man is wicked and they're not abiding by the laws, I got to trust you that at the end of the day, vengeance is mine, said the Lord. I will repay. I got to trust you. Like, it's a hard thing. You have to believe that everything that Hitler did, right, killing so many Jews and so many people because of his arrogance and what he deemed to be what was right. And so now when it comes to face the consequences for his actions, he take the easy way out and kill himself. And from the outside looking in, that's not enough. No, you kill so many, you tortured and killed so many people. And it's not right for you to take the cowardly way out. Because you don't want to be killed. And so you have to believe that, God, I believe that you're not only, although men may think that they're getting away on earth, God, I have to believe that you are the ultimate just judge. And at the end of the day, although you may get away with it here, in this realm, you won't escape it in the next realm. Right? We have to. Hey, Tanya, thank you for chiming on. At the end of the day, as men and women that stand up for what is right, we understand that we're living in a world that is not governed by spiritual laws, right? And although the world is not governed by spiritual laws, we still got to hold men accountable. Like if I tell you, even not saved, unsaved, ain't talking. We're just not talking about Christians and believers and unbelievers, but you have to hold people accountable to their own words. Like that is not a Christian thing. That is not a saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost thing. If you say you're gonna do something, then do it. If you make a law, or you make a decree, and you said that this was what you're gonna do, then do it. And when men don't do what's written, then we gotta hold them accountable, saved or unsaved. In the court of law, we gotta hold them accountable. And even in us standing up for justice, when we don't see it, then that's when we say, okay, God, I trust you. I trust you. It wasn't right. The crime didn't fit the time, but you see everything, and I have to trust you in this situation, right? But a lot of times, let me tell you what we do as the church sometimes. We want to sit back and allow God to take care of everything. And that day is coming. That day is coming. If you ever read the book of Revelations, you know that day judgment and justice is coming for the entire earth, for the entire world, right? But until that day comes, God has given us responsibility as his mouthpiece and his hands in the earth. And there are certain things that we have to do as men and women, as mature believers, to stand up and fight for those things that are not right. And when I say fight, I'm not talking about, you know, picking up rocks and throwing it at policemen or nothing like that. But I'm saying God has given us a voice. Revelation said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. There's something that the redeemed has to say, and we should say it, and we shouldn't sit back and allow God, oh no, I know you're going to take care of it, so I'm just going to sit back in my own rocking chair and worry about my own. No. Look, if Martin Luther King or Malcolm X would have not said anything, I don't know what the progression of, if Medgar Evers and all these other men that stood up and fought for equality for black people, I don't know what we would look like as a race. But God gave them the ability to stand up and say something, and they did it they did it in boldness, right? So God's timing doesn't exclude our fight. God's timing doesn't exclude our fight. So we know that ultimately God is going to take care of all injustice at the end. But we still have a responsibility to do, since we live on the earth that God has given us to live on, right? example. Let me give you an example. Moses speaks and demonstrates to Pharaoh what God wanted him to tell Pharaoh, because Pharaoh was being unjust. And so God could have sent all the plagues that he wanted to send without even using Moses. God could have got the attention of Pharaoh just by himself if he really wanted to. But scripture says that we are co-laborers with Christ. And so God uses a man in Moses to be his mouthpiece and his hands in the eyesight of an unjust judge or an unjust king. So God comes to Moses and said, Moses, this is what I want you to go to Pharaoh and say. And when he don't agree with what I'm telling you to say, then I'm gonna equip you with power so that there can be evidence behind what you say. But if you don't say nothing, then I can't show my power in the eyesight of an unjust king. You have to say something first, Moses. And so this is what I want you to say. Let my people go. Right? Verse 33. Must God tailor his justice to our demands? Elihu said, must God tailor his justice to our demands? God's justice is not determined by how we feel. That's what Elihu is simply saying. God is not going to tailor his justice to how you feel. Like I said, there have been many times that I cried in my feelings. God, I'm sorry. Please forgive me and don't allow me to go through this thing. But God is saying, I see your crocodile tears. And sometimes there was crocodile. And that's why we got to trust God, because he know the heart of men. But sometimes I was serious about, and I was authentic in my apology. But even in me being authentic, God understands, no, Marcus, there's a law that I've set in the earth, and you're going to go through it. It's not going to kill you. I'm going to give you strength to go through it, but you're going to go through it because you're going to learn this lesson, right? So we can cry, beg, and feel sorry for someone, but justice must still be the outcome. Like you can feel so sorry that a person is going through whatever it is that they're going through. But just because you feel sorry for a person that is going through whatever it is, look, I got a nephew that done some things when he was young. And because he done some things when he was young, he had to face the consequences. And although I thought that the time he got didn't fit the crime, what I wrote to the judge, no matter, you know, how much I spoke on his behalf or however, you know, other people wrote and spoke on his behalf, that did not change the sentence. Right. And so I really felt and I was really interceding on his behalf that God would do something that would change that whole situation around. God shorten the sentence or make something happen where, you know, he would see it and be thankful and it'll change his heart and it'll change his mind. And no matter how much we prayed that for him, it still didn't change. Like I had an auntie who was dying of breast cancer. And before she passed, I prayed and me and my family got together and we lifted her up before the Lord and we prayed and cried and we believed that God was able to heal. And just because we prayed and cried and it was authentic and we was really believing and really had faith, she still passed away because of the breast cancer. Like, something doesn't change just because you feel sorry in the moment for that individual or that person. Like, I'm not saying, you know, death was the justice. I'm not saying 30 years was the justice. That's not what I'm saying. My point is what I'm hoping that you to see, that God looks at the deeds and the heart of an individual. And he gives the outcome or the consequence based on knowing the heart of an individual. And so we can intercede, we can pray, we can cry, we can pray, we can do all these things, but it's still at the end of the day, we got to say, God, I trust you, even though it didn't work out the way that I think it should have worked out. Right? And so in my closing, I want to hit two scriptures, Deuteronomy 13, Deuteronomy 13. I know people like they want to see it in the Old Testament and New Testament. So let's look at Deuteronomy 13, 6 through 10. Deuteronomy 13, 6 through 10. And it says, suppose someone secretly entice you, even your brother, your son or daughter, your beloved wife, or your closest friend, and says, let us go worship other gods, gods that neither you nor your ancestors have known. Verse 7, they might suggest that you worship the gods of people who live nearby or who came from the ends of the earth. But do not give in or listen. Have no pity or do not spare or protect them. Verse 9, you must put them to death. Strike the first blow yourself, and then all the people must join in. Stone the guilty ones to death because they have tried to draw you away from the Lord your God who restored you from the land of the Egypt when you was in slavery. Hey, Karina, thank you for chiming on. Miss Steele, thank you for chiming on. Miss Hart, thank you for chiming on. God is telling Moses to tell the children of Israel that if anybody commit this crime of attempting to draw you away, then you need to kill them right then on the spot. You need to take action right then on the spot. You need to bring justice right then on the spot. Not only you, but the community. See, back in those days, if you was to do something like that, they would bring you out into the public square, the whole community, right? And the whole community will pick up stones and stone you to death. Because justice demands, wrongdoing demands justice. Like consequences demands justice. Sin demands justice. And forgiveness, but not without justice. Let's look over to 2 Corinthians 7, 8 through 9. And that first scripture, if you want to read it for yourself, Deuteronomy 13, 6 through 10. 2 Corinthians 7, 8 through 9. And then I'm out of here. 2 Corinthians 7, 8 through 9. And it says, this is Paul speaking. I am not sorry that I sent that severe letter to you. Though I was sorry at first, for I know it was painful to you for a little while. Now I am glad I sent it, not because it hurt you, but because the pain caused you to repent and change your ways. It is that kind of sorrow God wants for his people to have, so you are not harmed by us in any way. For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There is no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. So Paul is just simply saying, look, hey, in that letter that I sent you the other day, I know I said some harsh stuff, right? And at first, I didn't want to send it because I knew it was going to hurt your feelings. But I had to send it anyway, right? Because I love you. And that harshness of what I said brought you back to a place of repentance. And that's the type of sorrow. That's the type of justice that we need. That's the type of justice that we stand up for. Like, I'm not wishing ill. I'm not wishing bad. But you did the crime, so you got to do the time. And hopefully, in doing the time, it leads you back to a place of repentance to recognize what you've done. That's why God allows us to go through certain situations sometimes. He's not trying to kill us. But he's trying to mature us so that we can understand, no, I'm not going to do that no more. Because I remember the pain. I remember the hurt. I remember the sorrow. I still got the scars of a bad situation that I had to receive justice for. So let's go to the throne of grace. I pray again that you heard my heart and you heard what I was trying to say today. And justice being the forefront of forgiveness and justice and love and consequences and repentance. Working all of it is working together for our good. So Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we honor you, we magnify you, we glorify your most precious name. God, I pray that you spoke today, even if it was just to me. I get it, Lord God, and I'm understanding it a lot clearer. I don't see the whole picture, or the whole puzzle is not connected just yet, but I'm seeing it come together. I really am. And so, Father God, I pray that we see it as well as we walk through the scripture. I pray for my brothers and sisters that we may learn to mature as a body, as a community, God, as a family. Father God, wanting and desiring what your heart desires for us to have as we live and walk in this earth realm. Lord God, I thank you for putting the desire to forgive on our hearts, to learn how to love our enemies, doing good to those that despitefully use us, Father God, and at the same time, crying out to you for justice, crying out to you to bring deliverance, crying out to you, Father God, to lift the hand of the suppressor, crying out to you, Father God, to bring deliverance. Lord God, we see in scripture, Lord God, that because of Israel's disobedience, you caused them to be suppressed by the enemy. And not only that you caused them to be suppressed by the enemy, but they was being treated in the care of the enemy. They was being treated unfairly, God. But when they cried out to you, God, you forgave them and you dealt justly with the enemy that was suppressing them. So, God, that's how we ask in the earth today, Lord God. You see the wickedness. God, it's only two spirits. It's the spirit of God and it's the spirit of the enemy. And sometimes, Lord God, in our discernment, we don't see it clearly. We don't see it all. But you know the conversations that are going on behind closed doors that are not right. You know the works of men and the hands that are being deceived, that are being deceptive to our young men in the judicial system, to our black men, Father God, on the streets, Lord God, and other races that have been manipulated and not being treated fairly. Father God, we believe that at the end of the day, Father God, when everything is said and done, God, ultimately you're gonna bring justice. But until we see the spiritual side of this, the spiritual justice side of this, Father God, give us boldness to stand up and declare and say, no, this is not right. Give us boldness to stand up and declare your word. Just like from a spiritual side, God, it's so easy for us to stand up against the enemy and say, we're going to take this back. We're going to take this back. You ain't got this authority. You ain't got that authority. And rightfully so, because you have given us the power and you have equipped us with the mouthpiece to be bold in the face of fear, in the face of the enemy. So let us take this same boldness, Father God, in the face of this nation. God, raise up men and women that are not afraid to speak truth. Raise up men and women that have the spirit of discernment to see past, Lord God, what the natural eye can see. And Father God, we will forever give you all the praise, all the glory. God, that's one of the reasons why you said, let your light illuminate our light inside of us that we may see clearly. And when we see clearly, God, our good works will speak for themselves. And when our good works speak for themselves, God, ultimately it brings you glory. And so do that, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you for this moment. God, I lift up my brother Brenton. God, as you have prepared his mindset and the wisdom and you've given him wisdom and knowledge on what he will speak in the morning, God, continue to prepare him. Father God, and I pray for the people that will listen. I pray that they will hear with their spiritual ear and see with their spiritual eyes. Father God, that what he say will penetrate the flesh and the bone and the marrow. Father God, that may cause change in how we walk and how we respond, Lord God, and ultimately cause us to have faith in you and trust in you even the more. And we will forever give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Again, quick note, Brenton will be on tomorrow morning between 8 and 8:15. Not tomorrow night, but not tomorrow night p.m., but he will be on tomorrow morning 8 a.m. in the morning. So let's come with an expectation to hear what thus saith the Lord. Again, thank you so much again for your support. I always want to reiterate that you don't have to chime on every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. You don't have to comment. You don't have to do anything. But it is encouraging to us when we see that men and women like ourselves are consistent to hearing the truth of God's word. So continue to pray for us, and we'll do the same for you. God bless.